that now in English. I spoke in my language, Bengali. I'm from India. I came from India, and now I live in Portland, Oregon. My name is Swapna Mukhopadhyay. I think this slide of the show has a lot of pictures, and somehow the colors are not right. It is looking very dark, and you have to look very hard, closely, I guess. So, let me get to the slideshow. I never had this problem before. I don't know what's going on today. Firstly, I'm very honored to be here. This is something I cannot express in my own language or in English, for that matter, that it's such an honor to be here to speak with you, something that I'm very passionate about. And I might be making a lot of mistakes, so please forgive me for my mistakes. I want to say that up front and out loud. My voice is very soft, so if you cannot hear, just let me know. I'll try to speak soft, louder. And also, I have a lot of trembling because I have a disease, so ignore that part. Don't get distracted by it. I'm going to, before I start my talk, I have to cut it short. I want you to think about your own education. When you were in school, or when you see children around you in their schooling, and especially in math classes, how much is their connection of what's in their life? I'm going to particularly use examples from this region. Children are taught about patterns. Do they see patterns in their own context? Do they see that beautiful picture of fish, a fish trap that you cannot see here too well? And it's really nice in my computer. Do they see baskets that have complex trapezoids and quadrilaterals, examples of quadrilateral shapes? They see only what they see in the textbooks, but they don't see the examples that are in their lives. So I did some superposition of pictures here, which you cannot see. Mm-hmm. What is lost is that the connection. And this is happening not just here, it's happening all over the world, actually. That when we teach mathematics, we strip it off the cultural connections. And we give them just the diagram, just the vocabulary. We test them on the spelling, but not the meaning of what a quadrilateral is, and how the quadrilateral is tessellating. And these interesting mathematical ideas that could be presented so early, and that doesn't happen. So my presentation is about that. That can we do that, and how do we do that? So, revitalizing cultural knowledge, the place of mathematics, that's what I'm calling it, because some of you know me, and you know that I always talk about this, because people always think that mathematics is free of culture, and I always get the question, 2 + 2 is always 4, so what's the point? And yes, 2 + 2 is always a 4, but depends on who's doing the counting, and what you are counting, and how you are counting. In certain cultural contexts, 2 goats + 2 goats is not 4 goats because they're all different animals. So we don't put them in a lump. That sort of abstraction comes from a very Western ways of thinking. So we can get into that, but we also have other things to talk about. Let's see, will it help? No, it will not help. Yeah, that's better, thank you. This short passage from Fanon's really speaks a lot about what the status of education is, that colonialism is not simply content to impose its rule upon the present and the future of a dominated country. Colonialism is not satisfied merely with holding a people in its grip and emptying the native's brain of all form and content. By a kind of perverse logic, it turns to the past of the oppressed people and distorts it, disfigures it, and destroys it. As a result, what happens, we see globally, we lose our sense of identity and sense of agency. We don't know what to do. We are always looking for the direction. And can mathematics be a place to think about that? I want to throw another provocation. Okay, I'll read this to you. This is actually very interesting. These two are... We know that the belief that the whites have knowledge, that the Indians have wisdom, the blacks have experience, and the whites have philosophy. The third world has culture, and the first world has scientific science. Unfortunately, it's will and alive. This is what causes the stereotyping and narrowly focusing on who the cultures are, the broadly defined. So this is still how we think, that some people cannot do certain things because they are, because of the color of their skin, because the language they speak, the religion they follow. So we have created these false categories. And this is actually a product of colonialism. Again, I was hoping I don't have to read it, but I guess I have to because... This is about colonialism and decolonization. What does colonialism do? And I don't have to say that to you. You all are very aware of that. And at the same token, you also are very aware of the forces of decolonization that's happening, fortunately, in various parts of the world, and here in particular. That this active resistance to the forces of colonialism, how is that happening? How do we decolonize our minds because we are so used to it? How do we decolonize our thoughts, our bodies, our lands? And this is a part of indigenous liberation. So how do we get there is the question. And there is a lot written lately and a lot of work coming out from the Native American scholars. A concept called cultural survivance, I find very attractive. It's not survival alone, it's survival with resistance. And how does that then get unfolded? As we are looking at the colonization and decolonization, let's think about historically where it stands. That after the World War II, so-called end of political colonialism, the new protocols of cultural relations started coming out, and there was a reluctant but definite recognition that there are different styles of knowing. So these were the freeing oneself out of the colonial bias. It's a very slow process. But so what we started seeing is that intense studies of ethnoastronomy, ethnoagriculture, ethnobotany, ethnohistory, ethnomedicine, ethnomusicology, and on and on. So in this worldwide revitalization that was happening of cultural knowledge, so there is definite familiar themes, the language, social customs, spirituality, belief systems, but where is mathematics? There has been no discussion about mathematics in it. I was going to talk a little bit about the United Nations Declaration of Rights of Indigenous People because Article 13, 14, and 15 talk about educational rights and about indigenous educational rights, about their own knowledge systems and epistemological pluralism. But, you know, this is not working out, so I'm going to move on. And as I said earlier, I'm going to talk about mathematics as a cultural knowledge, and I'm going to talk mostly about ethnomathematics. How many of you have heard that term before? Okay. So ethnomathematics is a rather recent subfield of mathematics. It started in the early 80s, mid 80s, and it's flourishing in different parts of the world. It's flourishing in particular in Latin American countries and in parts of Africa. And it's a research that starts as an activism. So finding out what people know and moving on from there, how to take it to the classroom, because that is the healing process we are talking about. The schools are not a places. Schools have done a lot of damage, as we all know, that you know, languages were taken away, the cultural knowledges were taken away. One way of healing is through the schooling, and when the schools are done differently, the curriculum is done differently, when pedagogy is different. So ethnomathematics is in the process of redefining it for different contexts. So very quickly, this is the man, his name is Ubiratan D'Ambrosio, who you don't see too well here. He's from Brazil. He started this movement that it is the mathematics that's practiced by people. Many of these people are not professionalists trained in mathematics, but what the work they do that shows the science of mathematics that we call mathematics. So just to give an example, car mechanics. Many of the car mechanics have dropped out of school, but they do complex engineering. A carpenter does a lot of work, may not have done calculus or anything remotely close to that, but the work is very, very complex mathematical. Where does these things come from? So these are the practices, cultural practices, weaving, basket weaving, or weaving textile. They're very complex processes of thinking. They are the parts of ethnomathematics. So ethnomathematics is, I'm going to very quickly do this. What it shows in my computer is not showing on the screen. I'll just say that. It is actually an intersection of cultural history, cultural anthropology, and mathematics. So you cannot look at mathematics without cultural history and cultural knowledge system, anthropology. So knowledge is constructed by people, and it is used by people, and that's where mathematics resides. This is quite contrary to the standard paradigm of where mathematics is. So there are two aspects of ethnomathematics that are very prominent. One is acknowledging non-academic mathematical practice. And this is that a quote that I really find it resonates strongly is that the intellectual activity of those without power is always characterized as non-intellectual. And this is the combating that sort of mindset, you know, the stereotyping and all of that. That's a part of ethnomathematics does. And ethnomathematics also counters the dominant Eurocentric narrative of history of academic mathematics. For example, history of mathematics in many of the popular texts, it starts in Greece. There is no mention of the contribution of mathematics from other parts of the world, no, not even much of any interest in that. So very, very quickly, this is a map. Although this is not quite complete, I must say, that the way mathematics started in China, India, in the Middle East, and came to Western Europe in this very complex pathway. What it leaves out here, the contribution of the Latin America, the Aztecs, the Mayans, as far as we know, is left out in this map. So these maps have to be always updated for what we are looking at. So this is a part of healing. You know, the updating the map itself is the work that we need to do. And this is actually a part to reclaim our histories, reclaim our knowledge system, and ways of thinking. How much time I have?
According to
as much as you want.
Okay. Yeah. All right. So I'm going to very quickly talk about another piece of work done by somebody called Alan Bishop. He says all human activities can be categorized mathematically as six activities. Six human activities are mathematical, and that you find everywhere. It's culture-free, history-free. So let's see what they are. Counting is one. What could be the next one? that is mathematical, and you do in your life without doing school math?
Sorting.
Sorting is a part of counting. Very good, yeah.
Measuring.
Measuring, yes, good. Here
shopping.
Is measuring.
Shopping.
Shopping or shopping?
You count up things, you see if something's a better value than another.
Oh, okay, comparison, that's a part of that. Yeah, exactly. So designing. Designing is a strongly mathematical activity. It calls for very good, solid understanding of geometry and measurement, proportional reasoning, all of that that we teach in school and kids have a hard time. But it is a part of human activity. Locating, map reading, giving directions, playing. And it's not playing chess. All kinds of games have, you know, explaining and figuring out strategies. These are mathematical. Am I in front of you? Okay. And the last one is explaining, of course. We are continually justifying what we are doing. So what I'm going to do here, focus a little bit on designing, so show you some examples where mathematics is in culture and could be brought into classroom. And I'm going to skip this slide because it's a long text. It's by Franz Boas, where he talks about how designing is a fundamental part of human behavior. Doesn't matter how, if we are rich or poor, we are into designing. And if we take that, how many of you doodle when you have time? Or when you are on a phone or a boring meeting? We doodle, right? That's a part of designing we are talking about. So my first example is, I have to, in honor of the Plinkett basketry that I'm so fond of, to bring out those examples, which you cannot see too well. Every design, every band in this design is from a highly sophisticated mathematics textbook. It's not just the colors and the, it's beautiful. It's not just so-called pretty, but it's mathematically very sophisticated. And each one is different. And each one has a way to think about it. And it has, there are ways to make it formal and symbolic, and there are also definite ways of looking at it and telling it what is happening in each band. There are more examples here that you can see, and this should be done in the museum, but we are doing here. My second example is from the Plains Indians, the parfleche bags. These were leather folded bags. Like these days we go shopping, and when we are back from Fred Meyer's, we fold the bag away. It's the exact same thing done with rawhide, but done so beautifully. So these could be folded up, longer rectangle folded again, and they are all full of these adornments. So, and for some reason, triangular designs come more commonly there, and I haven't come across a reason why triangle was so popular. And there are different kinds of triangles if you look at it. So again, when we teach geometry to children, why can we not use these as examples? Of not just to look at it, but also to draw it. By drawing, we get to the meaning of the triangles, the properties of that. Here to the left is a drawing from Franz Boas's work. And what does the box look like when you have a block box that's to the right corner? You can fold it and look at the complex geometry there. How to make a three-dimensional shape out of a two-dimensional piece of hide or a paper for that matter. This sort of complex geometry is in the cultural homes, in their ways of thinking, and it's archived or it's suppressed, it's negated. And how do we bring them back? So we saw examples of band patterns, we saw 2D, 3D conversation, what I call the conversation between 2D and 3D, and making designs that are also bands, and very symmetric in properties, and the symmetries, that vertical symmetries and horizontal symmetries, they're also apparent there. By looking at them and by copying these designs, we automatically get to the mathematics. And of course, the best is to know from the doers how do they do these things. I'm going to move on to something from the Southwest because these potteries, these are clay pieces, absolutely circular without a wheel. And they have, again, another kind of symmetry properties. Two-fold, three-fold, four-fold, four-fold, three-fold, four-fold symmetries. Did these people take mathematics classes? I don't think so. So if their work is so mathematical, why don't we call it mathematics? And how do we take this to the realm of mathematics that we teach in schools? There is a lot of emphasis lately on STEM, science, technology, engineering, and mathematics, and some of us are pushing for STEAM and putting the A in it and calling it STEAM. I think this is, when you look at cultural work, it has to be the STEAM work, because arts is at the core of the work, the aesthetics of it. Let's look at some more examples. This is from Inca Peru. You cannot see too well the knotted strings. Can you imagine? Have you seen pictures of quipu? Quipus are knotted strings that for record keeping. And they look like, somebody says, oh, it looks like a necklace. It does look like a necklace. Lots of threads hanging down with the knots hanging, and they look like beads. And they are not beads, they are knotted, and the knots are actually decoded for numbers. And they kept records in thousands and 10,000s, so they were very sophisticated. They did not have a written language, but this was their way of writing down and communicating. So this is a picture of a man holding a big quipu, and that was kept for record keeping, maybe for census. We don't know from the drawing. It was done in the 17th century. And that's a counting board called Yupana. What is happening lately in Peru, they're introducing these processes to the rural areas. And the children are really responding very well. They're learning from their cultural artifacts, which had been otherwise put away for a very long time. So, you know, that's a very hopeful sign there. These are floor paintings, ritual floor paintings from India. It's done by women every morning to welcome the day. It's a spiritual aspect of life. And again, it's very complex mathematics. Computer scientists study these things. And also women who do it very hurriedly on their way to do other things in the morning. And every design is different. It's called Kolam. Similar designs you see in Angola, in Africa. And this is a way of storytelling. And you cannot see it in that corner picture, that somebody is drawing on a sand, drawing lines and drawing pictures like that to tell stories. The stories are remarkably complex and rich, oftentimes fables, but they also have mathematics embedded in it. And again, look at the symmetry properties of that. This is an example of the Shipibo Indians, also from Peru. They make these, I'm using the word complex so much because I don't know what else to call them, very symmetric patterns, not written down algorithms, done on two-dimensional space on the right and three-dimensional space on the left. And what is interesting, it's women's work. They have not been schooled. They listen to songs, healing songs, and they decode that in drawings. So if you do any Google on Shipibo, you might be able to find it. Or you can contact me, I'll send you some information. I'm rushing because of, you know why. This is my current work, boat building in India, done by men who cannot read or write. They cannot sign their names. But they make 60 feet long wooden boats by hand that are for commercial purposes, for deep sea fishing. So how do they do that? They have in their pockets not a formal measuring tape, but a string with knots on both ends, and it's mentally calibrated. So they just take the string and put it down and say, oh, it's such and such, and it's always very accurate. Sometimes they have measuring tape. It's not they never have measuring tape. But it's that mental, using the mental capacity of geometry and measurement to make 60 feet long wooden boats. I want to move on to what's happening locally. This is Jerry Lipka. Many of you know Jerry Lipka. And he has designed an incredibly powerful curriculum called Math in Cultural Context. It's from second to seventh grade. It has its modules, and it's culturally based. It's done with the Inuit elders over a long period of time. So this is, he has been the conduit, he says, that he spoke to the elders, he brought them in, and they designed these very beautiful curriculum. I brought two of the books with me in case you want to see it. I'll show it to you later on. And here is a picture of, strain your eyes. Mm-hmm. You'll see that they are working with elders. There's a fish trap and making smokehouse and various designs. How to measure one's body when you measure, when you, the measurement is in our body. So for making a kayak, you measure yourself because it's made to fit you, and same way for designing your clothing, your parka designs. So these books are very, very good. And I have been using them in my classes, and you know, it's amazingly strong, powerful work, and it's interdisciplinary, and the teachers and the children both really love it. The star navigation. I was wondering about star navigation myself, that now everybody has a GPS in their phone. Are we forgetting star navigation? Are we forgetting that how to give directions? How do we reclaim that knowledge? How do we bring it back? How do we bring that cultural history just along with what we are doing now? You know, this is the time of hybridity. We cannot be romanticizing it and stay in the past. We have to hold on to and valorize what we have, at the same time take on what we are getting technology-wise. I don't have a cell phone, so I guess I'm still star navigating. Rick Pinkston, he's a Belgian scholar who studied the Navajo people a long while ago, in the early 80s. And he talks about his worries about how the Western hegemony is capturing the non-Western systems all over the world. And this fear of this tremendous homogenization that's happening in schools, that's in curriculum and in testing. So we are more and more suppressing the indigenous knowledge systems. And this is not just happening here. As I said, it's happening all over the world. I showed you the picture of the boat builders in my own country, and I had been working with them for a while. In my family, all my brother and my cousins are all engineers, except for one. And they have no interest in that engineering. I call it vernacular engineering. They say, oh, you go there because there is very good food. There's no interest in those people's engineering because they have not been to school. Mm. So we are fighting this on many fronts. Mm. Huntunji, Pauline Huntunji is a scholar from Benin in Africa. And in Africa there is a lot of standing up against this is happening, standing up against colonization, how to decolonize our knowledge. He's saying that this appropriation of all the useful knowledge supposes and the conscious effort towards critical but resolute appropriation of one's own practical and cognitive heritage. This cognitive heritage we are forgetting, and how do we bring that back to our lives? That's a call that's all over. And that's what I thought I'll share with you. I ran it very fast and I was derailed earlier with the presentations. I'm sorry about all these glitches. But I would like to have a little discussion with you. Because vital part of emancipatory education is about strengthening our identities. Our intellectual identity cannot stand unless there is cultural identity as a foundation. And that tells us who we are and how we are going to go. So with that, Dhanubad, Nachish, thank you very much. And your comments, advice, and what your thoughts are. But before you say, we have a project in Portland. We are working in schools with a large, very large minority population, 95% or more. And most of the children come from homes where there are more than four languages spoken, three to four languages spoken. But in school, none of those languages are spoken. So we are trying to bring the language back in the classroom, in math classrooms. So we are asking the children to count in their home language. And we are recording that. And we are playing that loop. So they hear in 1 to 20 when they count in Swahili, in Spanish, in Russian, you know, whatever that language is, what does it sound like? They're teaching one another, although that was not a part of that. That is giving them a real strength to think about who they are. So, okay. It's your turn.
Clan houses, you know, it had to be plumbed. Everything had to be fit just right. Otherwise, it would have fell down.
Right.
And years ago, probably in the late early 1900s, a lot of our people could build boats, and they built houses, and they never went to carpenter school.
Right.
Play music instruments just by listening, and then they pick up and start learning how to play them. And I think that's kind of mathematics too.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And so the more we became colonized, and I was talking to one individual, he wasn't King yet, and he said to me, "Oh, you guys dumb me down." I shared with him all the different things that people used to do.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I kind of look at it as that too, because there's so much of our knowledge that has been lost. And sometimes I think we have been taught that we are lesser than, when in reality we were probably much higher level of thinking that in a lot of ways than what was introduced to us.
I mean, who would say these are lesser people?
Mm.
I mean, this is highly intellectual.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So it's nice to see that it's being told and said.
I feel like this. We have to take this as an activist position. Design curriculum and bring it to classrooms first as baby steps, as supplements, and then gradually. Because none of these things are hard to teach, and have partnership with museums so that they could always open their collections for students to come and take a look at them so that they don't have to look at the pictures. Seeing the thing in reality makes a huge difference to youngsters, to all of us. Mm-hmm. So this is, we have to start designing curriculum very differently. Connecting to families, what's called, we call funds of knowledge. There's a movement going on called funds of knowledge that there is so much knowledge in the homes, how do we bring it to classroom? And talking, the teachers talking to the parents and inviting them to come to the classrooms. Yes.
When a people are living in some particular area, be it that, to where they are living, I think some of the abstract art and there's another term, and it's still art, the native peoples, wherever they are living on the face of the earth, developed their own way of identifying their area where they're living, and out comes something that, you know, we're looking at today. It had a meaning for the people at that particular time. So I think they were way ahead of Picasso and Baroque in the art. The signs, the natives already had their own concept of signs. Otherwise, you know, how could they tell? Well, they told way ahead of some of the present day scientists, I think, when the serpent fish are running, they know when the king's salmon is going to be coming, and they know when this the different species of salmon, they know when they are coming, and they know what streams they're going to be going into. They know when the, what they, some people call lowly humpback salmon. That happens to be the best salmon for stripping and smoking, besides the sockeye in some area. They know from the what is now a piece of art, the halibut hook. The halibut hook is made out of two different pieces of wood, and they're wound together by either sinew, different sizes of sinew, and they know where to put the rock that they're going to be using. I won't tell you where I found what I know is a sinker, a huge rock that was used to let the people know when a halibut has taken the bait. They don't go out there with a whole scale of bait. I think it's the easiest way to land a halibut is to put your sinker out there with a little string, and you know, they know where the halibut is going to be going. And then they'll sit back and watch, and oh, they caught me, something was jiggling away. They caught a halibut, and they'll just go out there and bring it in. Very simple. The art is really beautiful. It's gorgeous, but it's based on where they are. And if you look at the Maori, it's within the nature of where they're living. And Yeah, I was in San Diego, and I saw a woman that was weaving, and they were using needles, tiny needles, that were long to make baskets out of. And then coming up here, walking through the trails here, the needles are three or four times longer than the spruce needles up in Germany.
Yeah.
Yeah, so you know, people, wherever they're living, they use their elements. And it's kind of funny to look at some of the work that Picasso has made, because in one of his drawings, probably found in the lower right-hand corner, is and he lifted the design from the Eskimo mask. That was really
I think he also lifted a lot from Congo. So, you know, this is the, what you are saying is so real, that the curriculum is local. When when I say showed the six activities that are, that's the way mathematics is, that's the curriculum of life, and that could be local. But our school curriculum is centralized, it's designed in Texas or wherever. It doesn't work with where we live. And there is this constant struggle then to connect to it. So.
I think Francis Paul made a little book about
I have
you,
that book.
Have
Okay.
She explains some
of
the
things. And the names of these are so poetic. Like the one on the top left, that's called Fireweed, Leaves of Fireweed. So there's parallelograms, you know, in technical term, parallelograms. Those are leaves of fireweed. And I've been looking at fireweed leaves. They do look like that. They stack up like that. So there's a reason for giving it that name. It's a reminder. But as you said, it's an abstraction. And we think that abstraction is not in the realm of us people, right? We can only do concrete stuff. But how did this abstraction come about then?
And is the book that you're talking about, that Mrs. Paul did, is it published?
It was I got it a while ago. It was out of print for a while.
But it went back in print?
I think Sheldon Jackson might have that. No? It's a.
I'm not sure.
I can send you the name. I can send you the name. Yeah.
What's the title of it?
I cannot remember right now. But.
Francis Paul, married to.
Yeah, ask Dr. Google.
Yeah, really. But I think what this all thinks reminds me of Shrapna is the importance of empowering ourselves to push school districts to teach math from a cultural context.
And it's not an individual issue. It's a member.
Francis Junior. Sorry. Thank you. Clarifying that.
All right. Thank you so very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.